to this meeting of Cabinet. Hope everybody at the back can hear me. Yes? Thumbs up, very good. Right, before we get into the meeting as such, I want to do two things. First of all, I want to give apologies for George Davies and Tony Smith. But the main thing I wanted to do is just say a few words about the horrendous incident in New Ferry over the weekend. It was a dreadful incident, a dreadful explosion. I was up there yesterday, most of yesterday, and I just want to say a few words really. And I'm going to ask Mark Camborne from the council if he'll give us an update. But I just want to pay tribute really to the fantastic work that our council staff particularly did on a whole range of different levels in the light of that of the explosion. I mean, we had people out there literally round the clock reassuring residents. Helping those people who'd been evacuated, making sure that they were safe, making sure that they were fed and watered, and for those people who weren't able to move back into their house, alternative accommodation. We had our structural engineers out inspecting the buildings. It was a fantastic team effort, really, by everybody concerned, who worked really well. Our people worked really well with police, fire, and the other emergency services. And I just want to pay tribute really to particularly our council staff from the structural engineers to the social services guys who were there. I know Mark Camborne kind of led the team, David Armstrong, just to mention a few people. But it was just wonderful, and I was so proud of the commitments really and the effort that our people put in. So from the leader of the council, a big thank you to our staff for the work that they did. It was fantastic and went a long way to reassuring people in which in a horrendous situation to make sure that everybody was felt safe and was looked after. So I just wanted to say those few words. Obviously there's an investigation going on, so we can't say much more than that, but in terms of making sure that residents are looked after, I can't fault any of our staff, so well done to all concerned. So Mark, I think you're around. Would you mind just coming up and just giving us an update on the situation, and we can obviously ask any questions. Thanks, Mark.
Chair, yeah, thank you. I'll just do it as a situation report, and then if you wish to ask any questions at the end, I'll answer those as best I can. So at 9:15 on Saturday evening, there was a large explosion which occurred at number one Boundary Road, which is a commercial premises which contains two commercial businesses, Homes in Style, which is a furniture shop, and Complete Work Down Solution is on the upper floor in New Ferry there. On the Saturday night, this resulted in 34 casualties being taken away from the scene. There was a large multi-agency emergency operation put in place and a cordon placed around the immediate vicinity, which captured Boundary Road, Underlay Terrace, Berrington Road, and the properties within that area. From that Saturday night, an emergency evacuation reception centre was opened up at the Life Centre in Oldchester Road, 1A Oldchester Road, and staff from the council and volunteers from that reception centre did a fantastic job accommodating and looking after a large number of people who came to that centre from either being displaced or actually people who were just in that vicinity and caught within the confusion that was going on around that time. The investigation strand from the police as we sit at the moment is concentrating on potentially it being a gas explosion, but that's not been proven yet, and they are looking at other causation factors that might have caused that explosion. But what it's left is approximately 30 domestic premises that are in a potentially unfit state to be re-inhabited by those residents. Those properties single occupancy or multi-occupancy flats above the shops on Berrington Road in the pedestrianised bottom end of the new ferry pedestrian area, down to Griffiths's, if you think of where the Butchers is there. The council staff were out supporting the rest centre, and we've had our structural engineers, as been said, working with predominantly the emergency services at the moment to get them access into the buildings to make sure they're clear. Gas and electric companies have been on site and they have started to undertake isolation of gas and electricity supplies to those damaged properties. Again, this is to allow the emergency services initially and now moving on to the structural engineers to get in and make assessments of those buildings. But the initial view is that there will be a lot of those buildings that will potentially be unfit for habitation and actually will probably have to be pulled down. That information and detail will come out more as those professionals undertake their surveys. The homelessness team are accommodating and looking after 11 people at the moment in temporary accommodation, and those were the ones from those affected properties. Others, so 30 properties doesn't equal 11 people, so a number of people have gone to make their own arrangements with family, friends or alternatives. We're gathering and have been gathering the information for those individuals so that when we work with the police and the cordon starts to reduce, we'll make sure that those property owners are either contacted and told they can go back to their property, or their properties will be made secure until they can make contact as we look to do that. It's important we try and get the cordon reduced to allow the professionals and the cleanup crews to get in, to get the business, to get the area back to as close to normality or at least clean in terms of going forward. So next steps really in terms of the incident are that we now are moving out of the emergency phase now, and really as a council we will start to look at moving into the recovery phase. So there will be a recovery coordinating group will be established. That will be led by David Ball, initially at least, in terms of that. And he will make contact with a number of people to sit on that recovery coordinating group. And really that's to make sure that we can keep a single point of contact and an oversight of the work that takes place both around the demolition, but also the important fact that even out of adverse situations like this, there are opportunities around regeneration and thoughts and things of that nature which need to be considered as we move forward. In terms of casualties, there are, you probably picked this up on the media, but out of those casualties that went, there are two casualties that are critical. One is a gentleman who just happened to be walking past the blast scene on his way through Berrington Road, and he has quite severe head injuries. And then the other is a more elderly female individual who was having a meal in the Chinese restaurant and has had severe lower limb injuries. And again, the information that will come out as we go through. Apart from that, really the actions for us are to set up the recovery working group. We are going to put out a communications plan and strategy to make sure that all people are kept informed, both internally and in the communities. There was a number of donations and the police who really stepped up at the businesses around there, Unilever, Brookers, to name just a couple, who were dropping supplies off for those affected families from the minute the incident occurred, and that those donations have been given out to those affected families. And there's a multi-agency meeting at 11 o'clock today at police headquarters where we'll know some more information, and that's really a chair in terms of the update.
Okay, thanks Mark. Well, one of our cabinet members was actually lives in the area just inside the cordon. So Janette, do you want to say a few words?
Thanks Chair, thanks Mark. I just wanted to put around my thanks. I'm within the cordon, so I was affected by the blast. And it was really frightening for me and for all the residents who came running out into the road. We didn't know what was happening, we thought it might have been a bomb, you know, because the blast was so severe. But it was really comforting in times of distress to see how brilliant you, yourself, personally responded to this, David Armstrong, and all our emergency services. And I just can't praise you all highly enough. And I'd just like to pass note of thanks not from me, as someone who's affected in Boundary Road, but also my neighbours as well. So thank you. Please keep us updated. And I hope at some point the cordon, as you say, will shrink. And I was allowed back into my house eventually, but we hope we get to the bottom of this. It was a community, it was a dance school full of children until 8 o'clock dancing. And it doesn't even bear thinking about if the blast had happened an hour earlier. I'm amazed and massively relieved that there hasn't been any fatalities given the scale of the blast and what's been destroyed in it. So I just wanted to say thank you from a personal note. Thank you very much. You've absolutely brilliant me. Thanks.
Okay, thanks, Janette. And okay, so to finish this off, I mean, I think I just echo Janette's words, really. I mean, obviously, our thoughts are with the people who've been injured and their families and friends, and obviously, we wish them a speedy recovery. But thank God there were no fatalities. I think we were quite lucky. But can I also pay tribute to the people at the Life Church? I think they did a fantastic job yesterday. I spoke to a number of the volunteers there, and they were brilliant just in terms of making sure it was a safe place for people to go and get refreshments and just to be kind of looked after. I think the Life Church deserve a big mention because they did a brilliant job. And then again, Mark, you mentioned the community spirit, I think, was just fantastic in New Ferry yesterday. You mentioned the businesses, Unilever particularly, donating lots of things, but people just coming into the Life Centre donating blankets and food was fantastic to see. So obviously a huge amount of work still to be done, and obviously we need to make sure that as soon as we can we give people as much information as possible. But I just want to end on the note I started with, really the fantastic work our staff did, particularly yourself, Mark. I know you were around all weekend, and I think I actually got a text from David Armstrong at 3:26 a.m. on Sunday morning. So the dedication of our staff was brilliant, and with the agreement of the Cabinet, I will write individually to all our members of staff thanking them for their commitment and efforts. I think it was absolutely brilliant. So Mark, well done to you and your team. Okay, thanks very much. Okay, cheers. Okay, so back to the agenda. So item one is members' code of conduct, declarations of interest. Do any members have any interest they wish to declare? Stuart?
Yeah. Thanks, Chair. The person interested in the agenda item 7 by virtue of family members' appointments.
Okay. Anne?
I've
yeah. Okay. And I'll declare an interest in item 7. Community pharmacy scrutiny review. My wife is a pharmacist, so I will be vacating the chair and leaving the room at that point, and Anne will chair that item when we come to it. Okay, item 2 of the minutes of the last meeting. Can we agree I sign as a true record? Okay, I'll just deal with this item, and then we're going to take another item sort of out of order. So item 3 is the leader's update. I mentioned the New Ferry incident. The executive key decisions taken under delegated powers that you can see listed. Just for noting, can we note those? Okay. Right, and then I'm going to move now to item 5, which is the tourism task and finished scrutiny review. And I'm delighted that we've got Councillor Jerry Williams. Jerry, I know you've taken time off work to come and talk to this item, so I don't want to leave you hanging around. So we've obviously got the scrutiny review report in front of us today. So I'm going to just ask you, Jerry, just to talk to that report, make any comments you feel are appropriate. Okay. Yeah, that's fine.
Thanks, everyone. Thank you. Right. Okay, yeah, so
Basically, this is the report of the Tourism Task and Finish Group, where we analysed the effect of tourism on the Wirral. And the participants in the review was the Local Enterprise Partnership, Tourism Officers, Wirral Council Heritage Officers, and of course our rather magnificent the Wirral History and Heritage Association, which encompasses all the heritage groups on the Wirral. We looked at tourism marketing by the council, an overview of Wirral's heritage assets. We looked at the roles and responsibilities of the local city region, local enterprise partnership for marketing and tourism. Wirral has the fastest growing economy in the city region, £368 million in 2016. We noted the success of the Wirral Heritage Open Days, which is an event organised by the History and Heritage Association. And literally 2 years ago, the Wirral's History and Heritage Open Days were the second largest, largest in the country. The only place that was ahead was the city of Lincoln. So it's quite an accolade for our heritage groups. And I think it was quite visionary, that was many years ago, when the local history groups and the council got together to decide that, in these difficult times and difficult times that are coming, there's all the heritage groups get together and have one organisation to represent them, and it's just been a magnificent enterprise, and it's a model that is looked at now by other councils in all sorts of other areas. Our heritage, we have a whole host of new initiatives that are being, as I say, copied literally around the country. A particular concern was that heritage tourism was not being promoted in an inclusive manner. So we had key tourism heritage sites that were being excluded on the basis of availability to pay in some of the promotional flyers and magazines. So that has now changed. We looked at the successes of areas like New Brighton and Port Sunlight, and a key area of concern was the importance of developing the Birkenhead coastal area, particularly from Woodside to the Priory, taking advantage of Wirral's waterfront and its spectacular views of Liverpool. We noted the great success of the rundown dockside areas of Liverpool that are now thriving with many innovative businesses, bars and restaurants, and the possibility of copying that on the Wirral. Going through the recommendations, the group, a number. One was to set up a Wirral volunteers group, where we have a group of specialists who can actually promote Wirral from the point of view of visitors to the area, visit various groups. And we want to engage a certain amount of training for those volunteers. So the first recommendation was that Wirral should engage with relevant stakeholders to develop and deliver workshop sessions for the benefit of Wirral volunteer groups. The objectives of these sessions should include understanding the role of volunteers and how they could be supported, providing advice and guidance on using social media and the opportunities available through Wirral Council media and other marketing opportunities, and delivering welcome host training through the Wirral Met College. So that is a process that is ongoing, and we have a similar things going on in Liverpool, as people probably will be aware of. So that is one of the recommendations. And the second recommendation was recognising the importance of Wirral's cultural offer as part of developing the council's tourism strategy. The review panel therefore fully supported the drive to integrate culture with tourism leisure and growth through the relevant strategies, and that this commitment is maintained by the council going forward to enable a more developed tourism offer. Recommendation three was a strategy should be developed to enable Wirral to take advantage of the return of the Giants in 2018 and deliver a programme of activity that will raise the profile of Wirral. This should align to the Culture Steering Group and emerging tourism strategy. And the what I would probably think most people around the table here would know what I'm going to say. The Wirral's heritage is absolutely spectacular. It has an international, local, national and international reach, and we want to do more to move that forward. And also that Wirral is getting its fair share within the Liverpool, with the new Merseyside area. So that basically is it, and I'm delighted to answer any questions.
Jerry, thanks very much for that sort of summary of the scrutiny review panel. Any questions from council members? Matthew?
Just want to say it's really, really positive, and thank you very much. I'm conscious specifically recommendation one ties into some of the work that I'm doing around the volunteering strategy, and I know there'll be a spotlight session for all councillors to play a role, so I'd be really grateful if you would be willing to come along and contribute thoughts on that at the meeting.
That'd be very nice, Matthew. Yeah.
Thank you.
And I think having people promoting the work or having volunteers is so important. We can engage and also engage people from, you know, the various areas of the Widow, and of course also then bring in on top of that the historical specialists which we have in abundance. So yeah, thank you for that. Yeah.
I just wanted to pick up on a couple of things. I mean, first of all, thanks for the report, Jerry. I thought the review panel did a good job on this, and obviously as our heritage champion, you're well qualified to make recommendations. I just wanted to talk about recommendation three, the return of the Giants. I mean, in 2018, that is a fantastic opportunity for us, and I think it exemplifies the way in which we're increasingly working with our colleagues in Liverpool and the other boroughs in the city region, because you know this is a great opportunity for us to work as a Liverpool city region for the benefit of everybody with something like that has a global interest and appeal. So I think that's a really good event, and we need to do more of that with our colleagues in the other districts. And also you mentioned something very dear to my heart about improving the offer at Birkenhead Market. I think that's a key opportunity. It was one of the key announcements that I made last week at MIPIN as part of the regeneration work and the growth work that we're doing. So I do applaud that. You kind of didn't mention it specifically, but recommendation five is about improving transport connectivity across the Wirral, which is I think an important issue to enable people to get around to our various attractions and facilities. So again, I support that. So I think generally this is something that I think a cabinet can get behind. Any other comments? Janette.
Thanks, Jerry. Just briefly, I was really interested to see reference to regeneration of our docklands, because we're really successful over the Baltic Triangle, and we've got the potential here, especially with our people and all their talents. So that's really one to watch, isn't it? I'm looking forward to that.
It really is important, and it's such an important site. You know, stretching from the north side to the Priory historically. But also it's an opportunity there for businesses to really engage in all sorts of other organisations. And it really, I would say, is the absolute priority that we can develop that area. And one other point I would like to say, the one thing we did know through the steering group, that in the past, many years ago, there's not always been a cohesive approach within the we now call the Liverpool City Region. There wasn't always a cohesive approach in relation to all the agencies. The one thing that really shone out from that our select committee was that everyone is working really, really cohesively now, and that is a really good mark for the future. Yeah.
Bertie?
I just want to add to what you said about New Brighton and the rural volunteers.
Yeah.
I tried to go to New Brighton yesterday but couldn't get in because it was absolutely heaving yesterday. But the role of the volunteers and the New Brighton's down there is absolutely fundamental to the way New Brighton runs. So there is a role right the way across the spectrum for the role of volunteers. and I appreciate that. I sort of work in the voluntary sector. I understand the importance of volunteers, as we were at a joint thing on Friday. So that underpins an awful lot of what we're doing. So I, along with Matthew, anything that I can do to help with that structure, I'd be more than happy.
I think that you, Brian, would be an excellent role model there, and again, volunteers that have got involved, and you know, enthusiastic volunteers move mountains, and it really is the way forward in this and these awkward times. And again, you know, we know that tourism is our number one area within the Liverpool City region economy, and we've got to do everything to push it forward. But as I say, we've got such a magnificent, you know, culture and heritage brief. Really is, it has a local, national, and very much international reach, and we need to exploit it for all it's worth. Yeah.
Okay, great. So, we're being asked to endorse the findings of the report and approve all the recommendations arising from the review. So, can I suggest that we agree that recommendation? And Joey, can I thank you so much for coming in? I know you take time from out of work, but thank you very much for introducing this report and answering the questions. Thank you. Thanks very much. Cheers. Okay, so I'm going to go back now to item 4, nomination of Civic Mayor and Deputy Civic Mayor 2017-18. So, very simply, I will move the following, that Councillor Ann McLachlan be nominated as Civic Mayor for 2017-2018, and Councillor Geoffrey Watt be nominated as Deputy Civic Mayor for the municipal year 2017-2018. And that this recommendation will be submitted to the annual meeting of the Council. Is that seconded?
Seconded.
Okay, thank you. Okay, can I ask, can we agree that recommendation?
Agreed.
Is that agreed? Okay, thank you very much. Okay, so right, so that takes us then on to item number 6, tackling fuel poverty. I will briefly talk to this item. So members, you can see from the report that this is an initiative to address the issue of fuel poverty. It is a major issue, not just in Wirral, but in many parts of the country, sadly. I have to say this in 2017, that this is still a problem that we need to address. You can see from the statistics that we have 15,568 estimated number of fuel poor households in Wirral, some 10.9%, which is a really concerning issue, and we need to address this. And this is an initiative in terms of setting up our own energy company in order to take action to address the issue of fuel poverty, and hopefully to move to a situation where we can offer our residents more cost-effective and cheaper fuel supplies. You can see that this is based on there are many other examples now up and down the country of these kinds of initiatives, which I fully support. I think as a responsible local authority, this is an issue we must address. So basically, I'm going to point you to the recommendations on page 36, which is agreeing to set up an energy company as recommended. And obviously there's sort of further work to be done by our transformation office. I certainly would not be averse to looking at partnering with other local authorities. I know that Liverpool are doing a similar exercise. I think there's merit in looking at partnering with them. But basically, I think this is something that is a high priority for us in terms of addressing, you know, reducing poverty is one of our key pledges. I think it's entirely in line with that. So I'm just going to move the recommendations on page 36, and obviously we'll have further reports back on this as the work develops. So questions, Bernie?
I just want to say what a fabulous initiative this is, and I agree with you that, you know, why we have ever feel that if another council are doing it, I think we should join up and we should partnership that. But I think this is just an extension of sort of the other really good way that this council does to help people in fuel poverty. We've got the Energy Projects Plus project that helps people if they want to switch now, and it helps them with it. It shows white goods and what have you. You know, if people can't afford these things, that project is there to help people who are in poverty. We've also got the Healthy Homes project. So we already have an awful lot in place that absolutely underpins the most vulnerable people in our communities. And this is just an extension of that for me. And it's a real Labour stamp, I think, on how we look after the most vulnerable, how we are doing our very best to look after the most vulnerable. So I
welcome
this. I think it's a fabulous initiative.
Okay, Stuart.
Thanks, Will, for this enormous initiative. I think it's the right way to go. I think for too long, energy companies have been ripping off the most vulnerable in society. No one knows why I pay for energy compared to one on prepayment meters, shopping. Also, find a shopping, you know, in Wirral, if you look on page 37. There were 15,000 people that were in fuel poverty. And I fully thought the way to go into this and for me doing this time, fuel poverty, so much the better.
Great, okay. Well, I obviously echo all of those comments. So, recommendations are before us on page 36. Can we agree those recommendations?
Yes.
Agreed? Thank you very much. Right, item 7, community pharmacy scrutiny review. I'm going to thank you, the chair, at this point. Leave you in Anne's capable hands.
Finished group, and the notice of motion about pharmacies was one that was a process of negotiation that took place with various bodies representing pharmacists, but those negotiations appeared to peter out or be met with a determination by the government to introduce a new system. And even last week, there were pharmacy organisations attending a judicial review in the courts, complaining about the way the government had treated pharmacists. Now, for most of us, our experience of pharmacists is somewhere in a shopping centre where we can turn to and get advice. You don't have to go to the doctors. It's like a first port of call. And in fact, much of public policy in the last few years has been to encourage people to think pharmacy, to attend pharmacies, and thereby give the doctors more time and space to deal with more serious issues. And various campaigns are run encouraging people, and indeed pharmacists as shops or organisations undertook various arrangements with CCGs to provide confidential rooms for discussion and undertook a range of services. The government came along and said, well, we're going to make savings in this process. There's a basic amount that pharmacies get per month. And whilst we're very familiar with huge chains involved in pharmacies, so I'm not going to name some of those companies, the bulk of pharmacies, there are 9 or 10 sites in Wirral where there are over services for 100 hours a week provided by the chains, but the other 80-odd pharmacies are all local businesses, sometimes part of chains, but literally rooted and embedded in their communities. And the fear has been that when the government reduced the fee to pharmacies, a basic fee, this would have an impact on the system we've grown up with and love. And that system, that impact doesn't appear to have started yet. I'm not aware of pharmacies suddenly upping sticks and going, although there apparently was one with a low turnover in Lower Heswell. The government's view was that they would introduce an access scheme that would enable some pharmacies to continue if there were doubts about their location or future. And in Wirral, only 4 pharmacies qualified under that scheme, one in Heswell Hills, Airby, Hoylake and Mells. That was based on distance. Very little weight appeared to be given to deprivation in the studies that were done. And this was one of the key issues that pharmacies were raised. So the establishment fee was being cut from £2,000 to £1,600 a month, £1,673. So this raised concerns about the future of some pharmacies in particular. Because I think nothing has emerged yet that we're aware of. However, we wanted to anticipate any difficulties. We wanted to ensure that there were services for local people in convenient locations. And during our work, we found that the pharmaceutical needs assessment was last reviewed in 2015 and is up for renewal in 2018. And between now and then, public health staff and the CCG need to keep in touch with the pharmacy services and ensure that there's coverage in areas that may not have coverage. How that will be achieved is still uncertain. The key issue was, this issue was raised at a time of uncertainty. There is still some uncertainty, and whilst there were genuine moves to change pharmacy services, such as integration with doctors, working on doctors' premises, working in care homes, that did emerge in the review and were promoted by the government as worthwhile developments, there was still an underlying concern, and that's what we addressed in the purpose of trying to ensure that no community loses out and that there are services that are readily accessible and can, as I say, provide the frontline access or advice, often by pharmacists who know their customers and know people in the community and know their history, just by pure background. So that was the reasoning behind it, Chair, and I'm grateful that the people supported this, and I look forward to Cabinet expressing its views so we can have a service that people retain confidence in and are pleased to see continuing in as many locations as possible.
Thank you very much, and thanks to the Task and Finish group for what is a clearly wide-ranging and excellent piece of work. Can I bring
community pharmacies is yet to be established. And as you also said, there's currently a judicial review underway. It might be several weeks until that's the outcome of that is released. It would be nice to think that we're not going to have any cuts to our community pharmacies. We'd be served really well on Wirral, and we really value the role of community pharmacies here. But I would just like to say that we welcome the report. We value our community pharmacies and the role that they play in the communities. The report's now being taken to the Health and Wellbeing Board, which is responsible for carrying out the pharmacy's school needs assessment, which will be refreshed on March 18. And that the updates on the recommendations, any updates on the recommendations, should be taken through the people scrutiny committee. I would like having to support the recommendations in this report.
Thanks, Janette. Chris?
Thank you, Anne. Can I thank Phil for his words about this really important piece of work from the task and finish. I think Phil's right, there's been a huge campaign around, you know, stopping people going into A&E and whatever and using the pharmacists as they should do. And pharmacists, I have to say, are so knowledgeable around the medication that they recommend for people. But just to say as well that the Health and Wellbeing Board have agreed at their last meeting that they will keep the ongoing brief that was asked for from the scrutiny.
It's just to add something, Christina maybe was saying when we were listening to the tourism scrutiny review before, the excellent work that's being done by some of these committees is absolutely beyond, and because it's cross-party, it's coming with a consensus from everybody, it's a sensible approach, and it shows that Wirral Council is at its best when we're all working together. And there's been a couple of really good examples of it this morning. So, you know, thank you for coming along today. And like we did with Joe before, excellent meeting to work with you to see us working together. For the residents of the Owens, the women, no matter what colour the badges that you wear. So, thank you very much.
Anybody else? Okay, well, clearly a very important piece of work, but a piece of work that affects everybody across the piece, as you've just said, Bernie. Every ward could potentially be affected. And obviously, going forward, what we want to do is monitor the impact of any changes that are made, particularly, as you've said, around the vulnerable communities, which are not, were not greatly mentioned throughout the review. And I note that your recommendations on page 69 of your report, number 7, you say you'll be undertaking another piece of work in a year's time, which will incorporate the other 6 recommendations and look at an update on that. I think that's going to be vital going forward.